Hi, this is Harish Thakkallapally. I'm going to present you today for business processing application using the DataTorrent on the MapR. So how many of you know about the MapR? MapR data platform? Okay, that's good. So let's go ahead with the I'm a solutions architect at MapR. I'm working with a few clients. So one of the clients is using this DataTorrent for their business processing application. So what exactly they're trying to do is they want to solve some business process problems using the DataTorrent, which is a streaming platform. And also they want to use the MapR platform for getting the database and event streaming and then like the file system capabilities. And they're also using the rules for rule engine because in that use case, they want to apply a lot of business rules before while processing the data. So once they process the data, they want to take some decision at the end of the processing, saying like whether is it eligible for automation or is it eligible to be given to the next system, right? So today I'm going to cover about MapR on high level, what is that converged data platform means, and then like we'll talk about the DataTorrent, and then we'll talk about rules for a little bit. I'm not going to cover in detail, but we'll take a look at it, a use case, and then application, which is I'm going to show you a demo on, which is going to run on the MapR sandbox. So that's, and after that, we'll have some Q&A. So I'll skip this, and then now let's see what is a converged data platform, right? So first of all, before going there, in the MapR, we have three different components for this data platform. The first one is MapR file system. So the MapR file system is similar to your HDFS, but it has some extra capabilities, where this file system is a read-write capable. So you can read, you can do a read and write directly, and you can use any of the Linux tools to write into that particular file system. And the second one is MapRDB. So this MapRDB is a NoSQL database. It has two versions of it. One is the binary database, and the other one is the JSON document database. So depending on the client's needs, they can pick and choose between these two databases. And the MapR streams, which is like the equivalent of Kafka, which is publish subscribe mechanism, messaging system, so that we also provide. Now, let's talk about this first scenario. Like, this is the current general big data architecture, right? So you'll have some data layer at the bottom, and then there is a processing layer in the middle, and the application layer at the top. So most of the time, application layer, the apps will be using the data, which is stored in your data layer. And in the general case, like what you see is like, for example, if you see the HDFS, that is running in one cluster. And if you take a look at the Kafka streams, so you cannot run Kafka streams today in the open source world on top of the same cluster. So, and the other thing is like the enterprise files, right? So this, I'm talking about the NAS-like file system, from where you want to access the data from that network file system, right? So in here, with this current architecture, you may need to have different clusters for different things, right? So you cannot combine all of them into one single cluster. So where MapR provides you the value is by adding all of them into one single cluster. So meaning like this is the converged data platform. So when I say converged data platform, you can use this data platform as one single data platform in one single cluster. You don't need to go for separate cluster for streams and separate cluster for the database and something like that. And now, what exactly we are going to provide? So that is a web scale storage. So when you say web scale storage, as I explained earlier too, so it supports both the HDFS as well as your read-write file system. You can read and write. You can just VA into a particular file and then open it and write it and close it down. So the second one is a database. It's a real-time file system and real-time database. So the real-time database capabilities, we are providing it with the MapR DB. And then the event streaming. So now the event streaming is similar to the Kafka I said, and this is also available on your one single platform and one single cluster. So now when we say about the event streaming, so you can access all the possibilities from here, like the event streaming and MapRDB, MapR file system, everything written on top of one single platform, right? And the second thing is here, everything is written in C and C++. Whereas if you compare with the open source world, everything is written in Java. So you will, in the platform itself, we'll avoid that Java garbage collection and performance stuff. So we will get better performance compared to the open source file system, HDFS or HBase or the Kafka. So that is one thing. Now, when we talk about the fully read-write file system, so we already covered. So let me go back to the next one is direct access NFS. I'm skipping a few of them because I don't have enough time to cover all of them, but you can find out all of them in the links that I provided towards the end of this presentation. So direct access NFS is like whatever the file system that you have in the cluster, you can mount it as an NFS file system from a client node, or client node or edge node. So you can directly mount it, and you can write into the file system directly from your client system. You don't need to do any MapReduce, or you don't need to have specifically for any other application. So you can just copy the files from your local client and put it over there. So this opens up a lot of different opportunities for the clients. For example, I can say, like, I can run my application itself, my web application itself, on an edge node, which can directly write into this particular file system. I don't need to have copy over the log files or copy over the file system, or I can use this as an enterprise level, highly available file system for any of my clients' needs. So that's the benefit you are going to get it. Now, high availability, I just want to touch one point on that high availability. So we don't have a concept of name node. So because, as you know, like the name node is a single point of failure in your Apache Hadoop world, right? So that we distribute, so how that is solved inside the MapR is, like, we have data nodes. All the metadata is distributed across all of your data nodes. There's a concept, a different concept that we use called as a containers. Within the containers, we distribute the metadata across all the data nodes. Even if one node goes down, so because it's already replicated, so you will get the high availability of the data at all times. And so the next one I want to talk about is the data protection, complete data protection. So the features that we get with the data protection are like, so mirroring and snapshotting. So mirroring is like you can mirror all of your data from one data center to the other data center. So for example, in case of disaster recovery, right? So whenever you have disaster, what you need to, so you assume like if your data center goes down in one place, you can still get up and running, all of your applications to be up and running in the other data center because it's globally mirrored, if you are taking care about global mirroring part of that. And snapshots, that is in point time, at any point of time, if you want to take a data, what it is containing, you can take a snapshot, and it is a consistent snapshot we provide from the MapR platform. So this is about the converged data platform. So if you look at from the traditional platforms that have been provided by Apache Hadoop versus the converged data platform, you are getting everything in one single platform. You don't need to have multiple clusters for each for a different operation. Okay. So I will skip on this DataTorrent because like Pramod and others have covered pretty much in detail. So what I will do is like I will just look at this development model, right? So in the development model, so each and every application, as you know, like it is explained as a DAG, okay? So this DAG consists of streams and operators. So these are the main building blocks of your DAG, right? So a stream is a sequence of tuples, and then when you say operator, this is where you are going to write your business logic, right? Or whatever the computation or logic, business logic you want to write, you can write it in the operator. So a typical operator can take one or more input streams or can read from one or more input streams, and it can do some processing inside that operator and can emit one or more output operators, right? So now, these operators, as explained by others too, so you can use ready-made operators, which you can get it from Malheur library, For example, simple like the parsing logic or parsing operators, you can get it from there. And a few of the Kafka input stream operators, those things you can get it. And if you want to really write something into you, which pertains to your application, you can write it there. For example, in our demo that we are going to see, so I have written an operator for incorporating a rules engine into this particular application. So operators has many instances that can run in parallel, so you can do it as a dynamic scaling and all those things. Those are the things that are available. And the other thing is stream has endpoints too. So like each stream has an input port and output port. So you can configure it in your application. You can control it, how many output ports you want to do, how many input ports you want to do, something like that. So this is about the DataTorrent. And next, we will talk about the rules. So this is a business rules management system. So the advantage, and this is a well-known rule engine available in the open source, and the community support is also pretty good for this. And also it provides the workbench, which is a UI, web UI and authoring tool. So you can write your rules in the declarative language called as a DRL file, which is a rules rule language. Once you write them, so the initially you may need to have certain understanding about the development or certain development experience you need to have to set that up. But once you set up, what this BRMS provides is you can modify the rules on the fly. For example, you can put all your rules in the GitHub, and you can just edit from there. Or even this workbench also provides a nice UI where you can go and add a new rule or modify existing rules or something like that. So all these capabilities have been provided by rules. So for example, here, this is how it looks like. So if you look at here, and this rules file, this is a DRL file, one of the DRL files that we are going to take a look at it today. So it can understand Java, meaning like you can have imports and package names and everything. And also, the main thing here is like the rule name. So you will specify the rule name and attributes related to rule name after that. And then there is a condition, when condition. So if a condition is satisfied in that, then it will go to the then block. So RHS and LHS, they call it as LHS and RHS. So you can always do that. So in our data set today, we are going to see, I am taking a flights data set, flight on-time data set, and we are going to find out what whether any flights have been delayed by more than 10 minutes. That's what our use case is, but I will explain more about that use case. So it's as simple as like you are taking a Java object and you're specifying some conditions to check, and then after that, you're printing it output. So just for the demo sake, I'm doing a sys.out. I'm printing it into the console so that I can show you how it will be shown in the operators. So let's look at the use case. So in the use case, I'm taking one open source data set, which can be available in that particular URL. So this data set, I'm taking it from 2016 December flight status across the US, whatever the flights that we are having. So it will give you all the information about that flight. So what I'm doing here is I'm taking that, I'm simulating the streaming part of it. So I read it from that file and put it as one message into your stream topic, and then I will read it from there, and then I apply rules on top of that particular stuff. So if you see here, so we are going to do the reading part, and even if you need, in case you need, you can write it into the database, and then you can implement multiple rules. I showed you only one rule for the simplicity, but you can do multiple of those in there. And you can deploy, because it's a Java application, once you run it, it will create a .apa package that you can upload into the DataTorrent RTS. So now, this is the general architecture. And so one thing I want to mention here is like you can use the similar kind of architecture for any different industries. Like for example, so you can implement it for trade marketing. So you can implement the rules for how when you want to detect a fraud, whether the fraud is happening or not. You can write all the rules, and that is one thing. IoT use case too. You can you can take the IoT use case and then you can implement the rules on top of the IoT use case. So whatever the data that is coming from IoT devices, you can stream it and you can apply rules on top of it to figure out what decision you want to make, right? So that is one more. And so operational, any operational monitoring stuff you want to do, you can do it. So for here, like just to explain here, like this, the first one, we are reading the data from a file. I have written some tool to read the data from a file and write it into MapR stream. And from the MapR stream, I'm reading it. So if you look at the second one, second block, so here, so this one is operator, so DataTorrent operators. So what it will do, even the MapR streams is also one of the operator inside this. So we read from here, and then depending on your use case, whether you want to store the data into the database or not. So if for historical purposes, few companies, they do store that. So in our use case, we are storing that. And then even, for example, if you want to find out something, you may need referential data too. So you can read the database table and get that information too. Once you have that from the map, the table, from the database table, then you want to apply the rules on top of it. Now, in our use case, we want to find whether this flight has been delayed by more than 10 minutes or not. So that's what we will apply here. And then once we have that, so next what we'll do is like, okay, these are the things that we want to be alerted as soon as possible, right? So we want to send them into the next stream, like the output stream or output topic, where from where we can see, we can send it to a dashboard, real-time alerting dashboard. So you can, we can build this part too, but in this demo, we will not be able to see this part, but it's very easy to do it. The MapR streams, once you have the topics, you can put WebSockets on top of that, or like you can do a polling mechanism to read the data from the topic and directly publish into the dashboard. Okay, so any questions so far before I go on to the demo, and then. So in this scenario, what I'm doing is I have a MapR sandbox downloaded in my local system, and then I have installed DataTorrent on top of that MapR sandbox. Now, if you see here, this is the UI. I think most of you are familiar with it. But here you have a develop tab, so where you can upload your upload your API package, application package, right? So you can click on this, but because of the time, I already uploaded this MapR DataTorrent package. So basically, you can click on this and to see what exactly we are doing here. So I only picked three different operators. The reason for that is I was unable to run all the five operators. I had like one is for the MapR DB, one is for MapR DB JSON. So I had a couple of more operators too. But when I run, the resources are not enough to run all of those particular operators there. So if you look, this is the DAG that we are going to get. So we are reading the MapR streams, one of the topic from MapR streams, and then we are parsing it using the CSV parser. So everything is a comma separated value. So we are parsing it and converting it into a Java object. And then we are sending the Java object to this particular rules engine, and then we are applying the rules on top of it, and then we are printing the output as output of all the flights that have been delayed by more than or equal to 10 minutes. So let me start here. Let me launch this. So you click on this, and it will take a few seconds to get it launched. And meanwhile, what I will do is like I will show you the properties that we are talking about, right? So you can specify the properties for the operators, all the operators that you are using. So for example, here I'm saying the operator memory, just keep it as 256 MB. Don't go by more than 256 MB. So I just kept it as 256. And the second thing is CSV parser, right? So when we are doing the CSV parser, we need to give a schema, like what each line, how each line should be mapped to your Java object. So that is done over here. And then this is the object that I'm using at Pojo. It's a plain Java object. And this is the CSV messages topic that I'm using it in my application. So let's go back and see how it is. Okay, so this started. So now if you see here, it has, this is the view, that logical view that you are going to see. and these are the different operators. And now nothing is coming in. Even if you see here, total number of processed and total number of emitted is zero. So now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start pushing the data into that particular topic. So I have some small utility which pushes the topics in here, messages into this topic. And now if you see like it's getting all the messages in here and it's sending the data to the rules engine. So, and I just want to show you the output of this data. Yeah, if you see here, like it will show you what is like arrival delays. I'm just printing that object itself. So this entire object, I'm printing it, which is comma separated value, but it's converted into Java object, and then we are printing it as a JSON in here. So, yeah. Any questions on this? So, yeah, I think I'm done a little bit early. So, any questions?
So you should
be answering the questions.
No, rules is new to me. So the rules for the rules, you specify them as properties for your operator and read them?
Sorry.
The rules for your rules operator, okay. Are they specified as a property? And
no, it's not as a property. Let me show you my code. Is it fine if I show you the code? Or
yeah, should be.
Okay. So I created one rules execution part here in the rules executor, and all my rules are inside the DRL file. This is what I have implemented right now, but we can make it as a, I don't know if we can make it as a property or not, but I had to research on that part, so.
And you're loading this as a resource?
Do you show the operator library? What is the key differentiation between your streaming processor and Storm, Spark, and Apex?
Yeah, good question. Are you asking about like what is the difference between the streams that we are Kafka versus the streaming?
Yeah. Other major players, you know.
Good question. Yeah. So, yeah. It is in the when I said like. Streaming MapR streams, it is API compatible with Kafka. So you can just take that code, whatever the code that you have, you can just use it. For example, here, let me go over this operator. So, okay, this is the application, right? So in this application, I am using the Kafka single input operator itself, so which is provided by the Malheur library, right? So only change that we'll be doing it is in the two places. One is the library that you need to use when you are creating this particular project. You need to use the MapR libraries instead of Kafka. That is first thing. Second thing is the properties. Like the if you look at here, the topic name here is a little different compared to the Kafka. So it starts with this stream plus topic name. Stream colon topic name. That is the convention followed by the MapR. Okay, so now if you look at here in the application, so what I'm doing here is I'm just using the Kafka single port input operator. I'm adding it as a one operator. So I did not code for this. So just it's like use that operator which is available ready-made. And then I'm also using CSV parser, so which is also from Malheur library. So what I have added is rules operator. If I go into the rule operator, so this is the simple code that I have written for how to read the stream, which is coming in the input port. I'm taking it, I'm processing, I'm executing the rules. I'm executing the rules here by calling that rule executor implementation, so that I have done. And at the end, I'm emitting that particular tuple or that particular POJO object. So when I emit it, so it puts into the output operator here. So output port. So when we have that, so we can see that in the your console. So that is how you will get it. So but it is as simple as this one. And if you see here, MapR DB operator, I have to do some little bit different for this MapR DB operator. Somehow the open source library was not working with the change of your libraries itself. So I have to code this. I have to write a DAO layer for persisting the data into the database. And this can also be used to read the data from your database tables too. So because like this is very fast, right? So NoSQL database, which is very fast. If you have some referential data, you want to read it from the MapRDB, so you can do that too. So, yep.
You mentioned earlier that you're first taking the data from files and then you're putting it into the MapR streams. Is that correct?
Correct.
And is what are you using to do that?
So it's a basically simple utility. So I'm just I've written some code to read the file, and each time I'm sending it as a, I'm creating a producer and sending it into that particular topic. It's a simple Java code.
Okay.
Yeah. So it reads, so because basically in the Kafka too, right, so you have libraries, right? So you can, what I'm doing is I wrap that Kafka library part with the file system read API, file read API.
Okay, I was just curious if there's a reason you didn't want to read directly from Apex, is for read the files within Apex?
Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
I was just curious why you didn't read the files directly from Apex.
Yeah, I could have done that too, so, but yeah.
Okay, yeah, I was wondering if there's a limitation, but
yeah.
Sounds like.
So I just, basically I was trying out all the MapR related stuff, so that's
okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.